among this bunch of people out there. Can you hear me? I'll be in the dark.
Little bit.
Right, so this session is a question and answer session, ladies and gentlemen. So what I'm going to do is, we're restricted to one microphone. Great. So I'm going to pass the microphone to the guys and they're going to answer the question. So I'm going to run around the audience Annika Rice style. I don't have a jumpsuit. I wouldn't look good in it. And if you have any questions, put your hand out. And I'm going to use my best projection to project the questions to make sure that everybody can hear what we're asking. So this is not about us guys, this is about you guys. So does anybody have a question for these amazing guys on the stage here? Who's going to be first? There you go, I've got one. Can I give you the microphone?
Yeah, she's got it.
Hello.
Oh God.
Hello.
What?
Oh, okay. It's a bit of a controversial one.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh God.
Okay, so the question is, what went wrong with the Thunderbirds movie? Oh, hang on, there's a laugh. Can I go to Gerry first?
What movie? Thunderbird, our go is a movie with Thunderbirds in it. Everything, there's nothing wrong with that. Do you mean the live action one? Ah! How do you spell crap?
It's very, very easy to tell you what went wrong. Especially big-headed. It was because that they didn't use me, did they?
Does that answer your question? Yeah, that answers the question. Well done. That's great. Okay, who has a question? Right in the front.
We saw the mod version of Captain Scarlet. Can we see the same with Thunderbirds?
You first feel Thunderbirds, what now? Who should be asking this question is me, because I've wanted to remake the Thunderbirds, and I've pleaded and pleaded with the people who own the copyright, but when I go back today, I have a meeting with someone about the possible Thunderbirds. The only thing is that the number of times I've been told, you know, we're going to do a remake and then they check it out, so fingers crossed.
Okay, well, our fingers are crossed. How would you guys feel about a new TV series?
Well, I'd feel great if my voice held out, held out so long. Yeah, I'd be delighted. How about you, Ian?
Well, I hope your voice holds up too, because then I'd have to do your part as well as my own. Now, we'd like, in one way or the other, we'd like Thunderbirds to continue, because we all were in with that for 3 to 4 years. It was one of the great sort of career times of our lives, and I think it worked. You know, for the most part, it was pretty good. So anything that allows that Thunderbirds to come back on the screens, I think has got our total approval, correct?
Well, I don't think you can improve on something that's already good. And I think that the Thunderbirds are showing me now, that people see now, are the best you can get. A lot of people go on about losing the strings in that. There's a little true aficionados love the strings in that. And it's not a problem. I like the series the way it was, and I don't see how they could possibly remake it.
We just done David out of a job. What are you going to do? Yes, anyone else out there in the past? Yeah. You want a microphone?
I'd like to know just how much of yourselves as individuals were in the characters that you actually did the voices for. Scripted, but how much of it was in you?
I've been with them all morning. It's most of them.
Oh, definitely all of me. I mean, it's a wooden actor and I'm a wooden actor. I mean, I thought I was very much Alan Tracy, and I'm quite happy with it. It gave him a certain emotional quality.
Oh, God, I'm sorry, what's that part?
You see, yeah, and of course we had this love affair with Tintin, you see. And there is this story, they used to separate them in the studio at night, and they came in the morning, they'd be holding hands, of course. Yeah. So he was a little rascal, and I think so am I. And you know, I think I did imbue Alan with a certain savoir faire.
Still gasping from your ass, I don't know. What was the question?
What did you imbue of yourself into the character?
What did I imbue?
Well, it's a good word.
Can you say that in public?
Yes.
You can.
Is that right? You don't mind using that? That's okay. Okay. Yeah.
Look, it's a great. I tell you what. I think it was a matter of discovery. You got five fellas there working all the time with hopefully different kinds of voiches that identify each one. They've got to be different from each other, and yet they've got to be true to the character. And over, I think, certainly over the first part of the series, that was finalized, that came into play. So we kept our own voices, and you pretty well got to know the character a little more each week. Is that right? We never got to know you, but I mean, I think that's the way it worked. It's a slow sort of saturation thing. And I think halfway or before that, we found our voices, we found our characters, and I think it just marched on from there.
Well, as regards Parker, when Gerry asked me to play the character, we went to a pub in Cookham, which is the local pub, and he said, he called the wine waiter over, and he said, I'd like you to hear this guy speak. So we called the wine waiter over, and he said, would you let me see the wine list, sir? And that was the birth of Parker. I embroidered him a bit.
Shut up.
But you use yourself as an actor. And being a character actor, you project yourself into your characters. As regards Brains, I got him out of my head, and I gave him a bit of a stutter, because sometimes clever people talk very quickly and they can't get the words out. But all in all, it was just a great series to work on. And that's all I have to say, really.
So, Gerry, how much did these fine gentlemen bring to the roles, and how much did you stipulate for the characters that they played?
Talking about one character or everything?
All of them.
Well, first of all, dealing with Parker, I think I must have been on a trip to the moon when he told the story, first of all. A true story, folks, is that we used to go, during the production, to a pub called the King's Arms, and it was owned by a woman. The pub was beautifully run. Food was marvelous. And we went there for a long time, and we were always amused by the waiter, who was getting on a bit. He had his short black jacket on, and he was a little bit saucy with the ladies. I mean, I remember one occasion when I was having lunch, he was serving one of the women who served it up, and he then said, wouldn't madam like a pea? And that was the sort of thing that he used to do. And of course, the women loved it for that. But when it came to finding a voice for Parker, I was always fascinated by the way this waiter used to talk. And are you listening, David? Because you'll remember this. I asked you to go down to lunch every day for a week,
yeah.
And that we would pay for the lunch so that you could copy that waiter. Now, from there, that is the truth. The that obviously that formed the basis of Parliament. But David obviously moulded that idea until the final voice was passed and became tremendously successful.
Fantastic. There you go, pass on the back. I think that's the wrong way around. Okay, there's lots of hands going up. I'm going to go this side for a change. Hello. Oh, a Rush t-shirt. Fanboy.
I was just wondering what your favourite episodes were.
Oh, favourite episodes. I think we'll go with everybody on that one. So we'll start with you, Gerry, because on this side. What was your favourite episode of Thunderbirds?
Favourite episode? I think it would have to be the first episode, which was called Trapped in the Sky, for a number of reasons. I mean, first of all, I'm crazy about aircraft, and I follow everything to do with aircraft as things develop, as things go wrong. So it was a fairly easy choice for me to do something with aviation. But of course, the thing that made that particular show was the fact that the villain of the piece was kind enough to place a bomb in the aircraft so that when the wheels touched down, it would explode. And I really should have thanked him for that, what he did, because that was the basis for saving the aircraft. And some of the finest special effects that were made for that particular sequence. Unfortunately, Derek Meddings, who masterminded the special effects, is no longer with us, but he did a wonderful job.
Yeah, an absolutely amazing team on the whole show, I think. I'm going to pass the microphone to you, chaps. Favourite episode?
Well, I think I love them all, but the an episode that I particularly liked was when Parker met an old ne'er-do-well from his youth called Light-Fingered Fred, which I think I played both parts, so I swapped one from the other. And also, I mean, any episode that Parker featured largely in, I love, because it was such a wonderful part to play. And the scripts were so well written that it made our job as actors fairly easy.
It's very difficult, isn't it? I mean, when something works the way that it worked with smoothness, it worked with reality, and it just made itself known. And the great thing about it was that people, very early age, listeners and viewers, you know, from the age of 5 and 6, were hooked on the program, and that went on until, you know, they were mid, whatever they were. And so it had a tremendous strength. I think that had to do with the guts of the show. It was never compromised. It didn't have to slide into anything really sinister. But it was entertaining. I thought, you can't beat that. So the whole shebang, I think, deserves a great amount of applause for that. Coming up with that formula that made Thunderbirds one of the great attractions on British television, forever and ever.
I have no real favorite. I must confess, the two episodes that played another character I played called Ned Cook, I enjoyed those tremendously. I think one was Terror in New York, I'm sure, but everything was collapsing, and Ned Cook ended up on stage in a wheelchair saying, "I want to thank those boys." I like that voice, and I like that character very much. I mean, I loved Alan, but I mean, I remember those two episodes with Ned Cook. And if you check your internet, you find the Ned Cook at the website, by the way. So, thank you very much.
I think that's a fantastic family friendly website.
Yes.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, there's a question over here.
Which is your favourite Thunderbird vehicle?
Oh, favourite Thunderbird vehicle. Has everybody seen the Thunderbird vehicles that we have on display? They're amazing. Okay, which is your favourite vehicle?
My rocket ship, what do you think? I mean, God, I was 21 years old, I'm flying them, I'm an astronaut. I love my rocket ship, what else? But there was also those little buggies we used to go around on, the, like a hover buggy or whatever it was. I remember we did an episode with crocodiles and I fell off on something. My rocket ship, I love my rocket ship. Very fairly, if I know, sorry.
I love my rocket ship. Anyway, I certainly like being in the sort of vanguard of the rescue missions. I just like the look of Thunderbird 1, and it worked. I didn't ram you once, did I? You came awfully close to it.
Much smaller than mine.
What was?
Your ship.
My ship. Was it? How'd you arrange that? No. Anyway, I think we all probably had our favorites, but you get used to the one you're driving with the most of the time. And it worked, that's what I say. I mean, you became very much at home with the thing. What about you, Devitt?
My favourite vehicle was Fair One, because I drove it.
Oh, this is so surreal, it's amazing. Which was your favourite vehicle?
Has anybody here got a good memory?
Yeah,
I just had a premonition. Must be something to do with this atmosphere. It came into my ear there. Thunderbird 2.
Apparently it's Thunderbird 2. Oh no. No, we'll never live this one down. Okay, who's got a question over here? We've got one person over here in the doorway.
How did you come up with all the features on Tracy Island?
Oh, one that I built. Some of those features are really difficult. Right.
Well, something that grew up in the early days of making the series, I always try to make my shows believable. I mean, they're totally unbelievable, but I think it'd be well done then for the short time that the audience got, they could be taken in and believe that everything is real. Talking about reality here, I thought while we were making the show with all these incredible machines that could do pretty well anything, that there must be some countries in the world who would love to get the designs to use them for war purposes, not for saving life. So we made a big ploy of safeguarding the secrets in Tracy Island. So hence, where the Thunderbird 1 was launched from under the water, so that normally nobody would see that. And also the roundhouse where the rocket took out off from the centre. I've often wondered that when that Thunderbird took off and the burners were in parallel with the bedrooms just for a moment, I wanted to dive in and see all the women with their clothes burnt up. but it was a kids' show, so it'll happen when we remake it.
I think that's the late night version. That's in that one. Yeah, definitely in that one. Okay, we've got time for two more questions, guys. So one from this side and one from this side. So anybody over there got a question? No? Anybody over here got a question? Thank you. You lost out over there now.
Which is their favourite piece of music from Thunderbirds by Barry Gray?
Which is your favourite bit of music from Thunderbirds? Okay, shall I get some chaps up here? Music? Oh, hang on. No?
Favourite bit of music? Well, the theme.
Yeah,
absolutely. I don't know. That's not even that, though. That haunts me, actually. I dream about that theme. It's the Thunderbirds theme is the wonderful theme. That's all. I also like this song that Cliff Richard sang up in Thunderbirds Are Go in the film with the shadows behind. I thought that was wonderful. You know, I like that very much. You?
Are you through?
Yeah.
You had two choices, you know.
I know.
Again, it's a theme that brings you right back into the. Into the view of the program, it's really a rouser, that one, by Barry Gray. I don't know how he did it, this little ivory tower on the Isle of Wight, or whatever it was. But he certainly, now that has something to do with his love of the program, of the show, and the characters in it. And that music stings right, and everybody was with it.
Well, I can only agree with what my dear friends have said. I mean, Barry Gray was a genius, and he composed a lot of work for Gerry. But I think the ultimate was the theme song from Thunderbirds, you know, especially with the intro, a fantastic intro which set off every episode. So thanks, Barry, wherever you are.
One last question then. Who's got one more question? Oh, okay, over here. Hello.
I want to ask Parker, what was it like recording a single and going to the studio, and did it make you a big musical superstar? And you,
yeah. Did fame go to Parker's head? I think it's the question.
No, it didn't. Because I have a body screw. No, it was great. You're referring to the record I made with Lady Penelope, are you? Parker, well done. No, it was great. I really enjoyed it. So I was able to put not only my acting talents, but my dodgy musical talents to bear on it. No, it was great, and I think the record showed well, didn't it?
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that's all the questions that we have time for in the Q&A. Obviously, our guests are with us here this afternoon. They are signing autographs on the table over there. Can I ask you to stay seated so that the gentlemen can get their way back to the tables? But before they do that, can I ask you please to put your hands together for our very and the family of action. Thank you.